Suppose you are doing the other account, the other two accounts are there, no? Rajesh and Sales. That time, if it is Rajesh account means, you will be having the entry in the debit side. Look at the first journal entry. This is the first journal entry. First journal entry. In this, Rajesh is in debit side. Look at this. Rajesh is in debit side. Rajesh is in debit side. So go to debit side of Rajesh account. Debit side of Rajesh account. Two cash. 50,000 rupees. 50,000 rupees. If it is sales account, it will be like this. Sales account. That is second date, no? Sales is in second date. So sales is in credit side. Go to credit side. 2/11/2020. Buy cash account. How much sales is happening? 10,000. This is how you have to record ledger, posting into ledger. Madam, somebody asked.
Sir, I have a doubt, sir. If for a company, if I'm buying a clothing, that comes in purchase account, right, sir?
Sorry?
If I'm buying a clothes for the company, for any of the manufacturing company or any of the company, that comes in the purchase account, right?
You are buying clothing?
Yes.
Okay.
So that comes in the purchase account?
For whom?
For the trading company.
For the?
Trading company.
No, you are buying, right? You are the company.
Yes, sir.
Okay. For you, it is a purchase. Yes, correct.
And in case if I'm showing like so-and-so company I've purchased a cloth, so the account will be made on the name of that company or it has to be called as purchase account only? That ledger posting will be done on the company name or it will be like a purchase account?
See, what is your name?
Sir, Vibha.
Huh?
Vibha.
Is the company? Right?
Yes, sir.
You are running a company. Okay.
Sir.
That company is buying clothes. Okay?
Sir.
Buying clothes from whom?
From ABC company or somebody, sir.
Okay, ABC company. Okay, for how much?
For 7 lakh rupees or something, 10 lakhs or something.
7 lakhs. Okay, now you tell me what you want to know. You
sir,
pay
just
money
wanted,
or not?
Sir, in case if I'm buying it in cash or
you
in
paid
credit,
money.
Whatever.
You paid money, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now what is your doubt?
So my doubt is when we are making this ledger posting, so because I'm buying a cloth here, it is a purchase. The purchase thing what I am doing. So the ledger entry what we are going to make it is as a heading called purchase account.
In whose book? In Vibha's book you are asking about or in ABC book you are asking about?
No, my book, sir. Vibha's book.
Vibha's book. Okay. What is the journal entry for this? What is the journal entry, madam? Vibha, what is the journal entry?
Sir, that will be cash.
Sorry?
Cash account debit 7 lakh.
Okay. Then what do you want to credit?
Goods.
It will be goods.
Why? What is the logic you are applying?
So cash account to purchase account.
What is the logic you are applying here to record the journal? What is happening? You are buying clothes from ABC Limited by paying 7 lakh rupees. That's it, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we have three accounts, right? Nominal, real, and personal. So which account is affected in this transaction? Vibha, you should answer. Which account is getting affected in this transaction? This is a transaction, right?
Yes, sir.
In this transaction, what are the accounts are getting affected? You are getting cloth, right?
Yes, sir.
Then what else is happening?
My cash is going, sir. Expense is there.
Two accounts are affected, right? Cloth account is affected.
And
cash accounts are affected, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, cloth and cash. Which kind of account it is? Nominal account or personal account or real account?
For cash, it will be nominal account.
Cash it is?
Nominal.
What is nominal? What is real? What is personal? How come cash is nominal?
Cash will be
cash
real.
Cash is always person. Cash, right? Cash is always cash, right? How it is nominal? Nominal means for our namesake, we are naming some name. We are coining some name for some kind of item. That is called nominal. If you see cash, you will say cash only. If I see cash, I will also coin it as a cash only. So it's a real account. Cash is a real account. Cloth, is it a real or personal or nominal? Yes? Cloth is real or nominal or personal? Vibha?
Sir, I'm confused, sir.
Confusing?
Sir, it's real account, sir.
Why real account? You please explain to Vibha, right? Without any confusion, matter, sir.
This is Chetan here.
Yeah, Chetan.
Since it is goods kind of stuff, so we can consider it as a real account. So nominal account, we can give examples such as rent account, salary account. Real account, goods, machinery, cash.
Yeah.
And the owners.
Owners is not real.
No, it is a nominal account, personal account.
Owner is a personal. Okay. So Vibha, please understand, cloth is a real account.
Right.
So what is real account rule says to record the journal entry? Real account rule says debit what comes in, credit what goes out. What is coming in?
Cloth
is coming in. So you have to write different, opposite of this. You should not write like this. You should write cloth account debit or goods account debit to cash account. Since it's real account, real account rules says goods account debit to cash account. What is coming in debit? What is going out credit? So now what is your doubt? Basically, you asked me, should I write it as a purchase or
company name account?
Company name, why you want to write the company name? Where from company name comes in?
So it will be called as purchase account.
Yeah, you can write purchase account. You can write purchase account or goods account, or you can write simply cloth account. Cloth is also, again, is a general term. Which cloth? You can write the cloth itself. The name of the specific cloth itself. Cloth is very common term, right? So you can write any one of these. Purchase account debit or goods account debit or cloth account debit. Depending upon your accounting policy, what you are following. Some company will write purchase, somebody will write goods, somebody will write the name of the goods itself. Normally it's a goods only, but goods in the same company, maybe there are 3-4 goods will be there. To have a differentiation, we will write the name of the exact goods. That's cloth. Again, cloth is very common. Okay, you can give a code or you can name the cloth itself. To cash. If you pay the cash, to cash. Or if you did not pay the cash, that time you would write ABC company account. If you did not pay cash, that time it will come. If you pay cash, 7 lakh rupee, if you paid it to ABC Limited, then there is no need of writing ABC Limited in the credit side. You have to write only cash.
Right, sir, right, sir.
Okay.
Right, sir.
This is very first class, no? If you understand now, at least. Okay, all right. Any other doubt? Any other doubt regarding the previous sessions? Anybody has any other doubt?
No, sir.
No? Let me move on to the next area. Abhinand, Mr. Abhinand, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Abhinand Dev Chandra. How are you, man?
Doing good, sir. How about you?
Doing good, great. So, what is trial balance? Can you recollect what is trial balance?
Yes, sir.
You are recollecting?
Yes, sir. 1 minute, sir. You want me to tell the definition, sir?
The definition, you define, no problem. According to Abhinand, what is trial balance? You can give your definition, no problem. Yeah, Akhil Xavier, can you help Abhinand in understanding, sir, what is trial balance quickly?
Sir,
you also want somebody to help? Quick, we don't have time.
Can I, sir?
Yeah, sir. Who is that?
Wilson.
Wilson, please, Wilson.
Sir, it's a list of all general ledger accounts, sir, in a business.
List of all?
General ledger accounts.
If it is non-general ledger account, then where, what will you do? Oh, it is list of all general ledger account.
Yeah.
Is there any other ledger account is there? General ledger or something else is there?
Right. List of ledger accounts.
List of ledger accounts?
Yes.
Okay, all of you agrees with, all of you agree with Wilson? I am disagreeing. Anybody is supporting me? Is it a list of all ledger accounts? Anybody?
Total, it's a total of.
Oh, total, like, of all ledger
each,
accounts.
No, no, not all the ledger accounts, each type of ledger account. Like if it is a purchase, one purchase account total. Or whatever is left behind, credit and debit.
Can you see the screen now, all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
There is a table, right?
Yes.
So what this is? What is this table all about?
It has all debits and credits.
Journal entries.
Yeah, it has. So what do you call this? This table is called as?
Journal entries.
Journal entry.
Journal posting.
Journal posting.
It's a trial balance.
Sir, that's a trial balance.
Trial balance. Somebody found out very correctly. It is a trial balance. Look at this. The following is the trial balance. Proof is given here. Right? Following is the trial balance. It is the trial balance. Then what is the trial balance? So it is the trial balance. Then what is the trial balance? That gentleman was telling, no, the trial balance is nothing but the list of all ledger accounts. And the other gentleman is telling it's a list of all common ledger accounts. But little correction in that, trial balance is nothing but a list of ledger accounts which has balance only. Suppose, look at this Rajesh account. Suppose Rajesh account debit side 50,000 is there. And the credit side, suppose 30-11-2020, okay, by sales, okay, some 50,000 is there. If that is the case, both sides are equal, right? Both sides are equal. Will this ledger account, should I write Rajesh account in my trial balance? Yeah, should I write Rajesh account in the trial balance?
Yes.
No,
sir.
So basic is not understood properly. The teacher is not efficient enough in teaching you what is trial balance is. I'm trying once again. See, all the ledger accounts will not appear in the trial balance. Please understand. Balance, look at that word, balance. If any ledger account is having a balance, that ledger account will appear in the trial balance. What do you mean by balance? The both side, debit side and credit side, are not equal. One side is more, greater than the other side. So the difference of that particular amount in the name of that particular account will appear in the trial balance. I tell again, trial balance is a statement which incorporates the balances of all ledger accounts. Balances of all ledger accounts. If the ledger account does not have balance, what do you mean by the ledger account does not have balance? The ledger account will tally automatically. What is tallying automatically? The debit side of the ledger account total and the credit side of the ledger account total is one and the same, equal. If that is the case, that account is closed there itself. Simple example, we are selling to Rajesh. 4-5 times we are selling. Okay, some amounts are there. And 5 times we received some amount also from him. If the amount goods sold to him and the amount received from him is equal, then there is no need of maintaining Rajesh into ledger, I mean into the trial balance. His account is closed. We don't want to remember him unless otherwise he comes back again and opens account with us. Suppose you are having a bank account. You close the bank account. Will you write that balance in the book of your account? No. The bank account is closed. You've taken all the money from the bank. Bank account is closed. Likewise, only those accounts which are having balance, will be written in the trial balance. Trial balance is a list of all ledger account balances. Okay. Now, today's class, we are going to discuss the financial statement of the company. Last class also, we discussed few. Okay. Now, we are going to do one more question on that. That is a big question which includes balance sheet and profit and loss account. Once again, I recollect the basic objective of accounting is to find out the profit or loss of the business and also to know the financial position of the company. Okay. In order to achieve these two, we have to prepare two statements. One is balance sheet. The other one is profit and loss account. To know the profit or loss, profit and loss account. To know the financial position of the company, balance sheet. Okay. To prepare these two, we want only trial balance. We started from journal entry, then ledger accounts, then trial balance. Now we are moving into the next aspect that is only based on trial balance. Ledger and journal is in the form of trial balance now. The closing balances are in the trial balance now. Okay. So in order to prepare the balance sheet as well as the profit and loss account, we need trial balance. We need trial balance and we need some information. That information is technically called as adjustment, meaning the raw transaction. That means the transaction which have not gone through any journal or ledger and it is not appearing in trial balance. Straight away it comes to financial statements. We don't have time to record these in the journal, ledger, trial balance, and are very limited. And it is appearing, it is occurring, it is happening on the last date of the accounting year. So we don't want to again go for journaling this, ledgering this, and bringing to trial balance. We don't want to do that. We directly give impact, we directly give effect these into the financial statement. So those transactions are called as adjustments. So in order to prepare the financial statements, we need trial balance and we need some information. Okay, that is given to us. Now we are going to prepare the financial statement of this company, financial statement of this company for this given information. This information was read and understood in the last class, if you remember correctly. Okay, right. So now I'll tell you one small point, that is, in the trial balance or in the adjustment, if you come across any one particular item, that need to be categorized into any one of these five categories. Look at these five categories. Any one of these five categories. What are those five categories? Any item given the trial balance should be of either asset or liability or equity or expenditure or income. It cannot be outside of these five. You name anything. Okay, that should be of any one of these categories. Okay. Either asset or liability or equity or expenditure or income. Okay, let us try. So first one, equity share capital. What is this equity? Equity share capital. Is it an asset or liability? What is this equity capital? Can you categorize this? Anyone?
Equity.
Yes? Equity. Owner's money is called as equity. Owner's money is called equity. Amount available to owners from the business is called equity. Amount payable to outsider is called liability. The value of anything which is owned by the business is asset. The value of anything owned and controlled and enjoyed by the business is asset. Expenditure means anything what you spend to acquire any service or acquire any asset is called expense. Okay, income means anything what you receive, what you sell and receive, what you service and receive money, that is called income. So equity share capital is coming under equity. If this is equity, so that will go to balance sheet. These three items will be going to balance sheet, will be recorded in balance sheet. These two items will be recorded in profit and loss account. First of all, you should make clear about this. You will be given with the trial balance and adjustments. You have to go through all those things. While going through, you have to categorize them into any one of these category accordingly. If the particular item what you find either in trial balance or in adjustment is of asset nature or liability nature or equity nature, you should immediately decide that item should be appearing in balance sheet. Okay, and if that is of income or expenditure nature, you should clearly decide that it should go to profit and loss account. First, this is the basic idea. Okay, expenditure is compared with income. If income is more than expenditure, that is going to be profit. If expenses are more than income, that is going to be loss. Okay, in balance sheet case, this asset is always equal to the total of liabilities and equity. You know already very well, the assets should be always equal to the sum of liabilities and equity, right? This you already know in the accounting equation, you already studied, right? Okay, now let us take this question. Equity calls in arrear. Calls in arrear means the money which is not paid by the equity shareholders. They agreed to buy your share and they have been allotted the share, but they did not pay the money full, still receivable, calls in arrear. Like that, there are so many items are there and adjustments are there. Let us prepare the financial statement now. You should be knowing about this format. In this format, only you have to prepare the financial statement. Only in this format. Okay. Now I delete this. we will be writing it one by one. Okay, we'll be writing it one by one. Right. So this is a format. You should remember this. Income. These two are income. These two are income. For any question, this is the format. You should not change this. You should not change this. Okay. These two put together is total revenue. Total revenue. Then expenses. All expenses one by one you have to understand and you have to bring it and you have to write it here. All expenses.
So this format is called in any name like IFRS standard of balance.
It is the format given by the Indian Companies Act 2013. All the companies under Indian Companies Act should follow this format while preparing their financial statement, and it should be disclosed to all the people. Yeah.
Okay, sir. So all the Indian companies
IFRS,
under this
one minute. IFRS and Ind AS are GAAP, and all other things are useful or guiding principle. How do you recognize this amount? Suppose here I have written sales. Look at this. I have written sales here somewhere. Yeah, this is sales. 2 lakh. Sorry. Where is sales? Yeah, 5,25,000 rupees is a sales. How do I arrange this 5,25,000? Is there any ambiguity is there? That time I have to refer IFRS or Ind AS or whichever the accounting principle I am following to recognize what is sales, to recognize what is expense, to recognize what is purchase. For that, we have IFRS and we have Ind AS and we have GAAP and we have all other accounting principles. Okay. Format and all is not told in IFRS. Only the amount of recognizing the amount that is being guided by the accounting principles. If you have any doubt or if you have any kind of ambiguity, okay, that time you have to refer that, not the format. Format is given by that particular regulating body, right? Something you are asking?
No, sir. I was asking the name of this format. So yeah, I got the answer. It's under the company.
Statement of profit and loss account according to schedule of the Companies Act 2013.
Right, sir. Yes. Totally. Thank you.
Yeah. Now our duty is to just bring all those items into this format. This is the given into. This is the state of affairs. This is the company's today's position. Okay. From this, we have to categorize them into income and expenditure to find out the profit, and categorize them into assets, liabilities, and equity to prepare a balance sheet. Okay. Now, first item in the profit and loss account is revenue from operation. Revenue from operation. Look at the word operation. Operation means your core business of the company. Core business. What is for you are? What is for you are there? That activity is called operation. Okay, for a computer man, for the dealer and computer, selling of computer and getting money is called revenue from operation. Suppose they have some old furniture, they are selling it and getting a profit. That is not revenue from operation. That is other income. Look at this, other income. Other income is nothing but any income received by the company other than the core activity of the business, other than the major activity of the business is called other income. Example, interest received from the bank on your deposit, interest on investments, return on investments, dividend on investments, okay, profit on sale of asset. These are all the example for other income.
Sorry to interrupt, sir. One doubt. For reselling of the asset, it will be earlier stage we have spent it for the asset, no? Resell it.
Suppose you bought an asset for 10 lakh rupees in 2010 and you are selling it today. From 2010 to today, 10 years you have been using that asset. So according to you, your accountant will tell what is the book value of that asset today. Say for example, every year you are depreciating 50,000 rupees. 10 lakh is the original value of the asset. 10 years you have used it. Every year you have depreciated 50% of 50,000 of the value. So 10 years into 50,000 is equal to 5 lakhs. According to your book, 5 lakh is the usage of that asset. But you bought it for 10 lakhs. So the net value of the asset, book value of the asset, depreciated value of the asset is 5 lakhs. But you are selling that asset today for 6 lakhs. So you are getting a profit of 1 lakh. This 1 lakh is not your operating revenue. This 1 lakh is your other income. Because buying and selling of machine is not your main operation of the company. You bought a machine for your purpose of operation. You have been doing it. Now you feel that that machine is becoming old. A new technology has come. You are going to replace that machine. For that purpose you are selling. Okay. If that gives you any kind of revenue, that revenue is not revenue from operation. That revenue is from other income. Suppose you have been buying newspaper, subscribing newspaper for your office staff. For the last 2 years, you have been subscribing the Hindu. Okay. Now, that's mountaining of newspapers in your office. You want to dispose it off. You are just calling the old paper buyer. You are selling it. He is giving you 2000 rupees. It's a revenue for the company, but it is not revenue from operation. Selling of old newspaper is not your business. To support your office staff, you bought some magazines and newspapers. When it become old, when it become unused, you are just selling it. That gives you some revenue. That revenue is called as other income. I hope you understood the revenue from operation and revenue from other income.
Thank you, sir. Got it. Got it, sir. Thank you.
So both are income only. We are not eliminating that income. Both are income. But we are cash. If I want to analyze the company, this income should be more than the other income. Suppose other income is more than the revenue from operation, then the company is not good. I have to earn considerable percentage of my revenue from the core activity of my business. Then only it is good. Other income may be there today, may not be there tomorrow. Every year I cannot sell the old machine. Every year I cannot dispose of the newspaper. So that is the logic. So both put together is total revenue. Okay. Let me see the revenue of this company. Look at this. This is not a revenue. This is not revenue. Not revenue, not revenue, not revenue, not revenue. Sales is the revenue actually. So sales is, there is sales. Yeah, sales is there. Look at this. Sales is there. This is the revenue. Credit side, always revenue will be in credit side. One more easy understanding. Credit side will be revenue and liability. Debit side, asset and expenditure. Normally in trial balance. Debit side represents assets and expenses. Okay, in trial balance. The credit side represents the credit side item. The credit side item will be of liabilities and revenue or income. Liabilities and income. That's the logic. From the basic of your rules of accounting, debit all expenses. That's why expenses are in debit side of the trial balance. Credit all income. That is why income is in the credit side of the trial balance. Okay. Debit what comes in. What will come in? Asset only will come in. So debit what comes in. That is why assets are in debit side. Okay. Credit what goes out. Asset goes out means it will get reduced. So asset will get automatically adjusted there. Okay. Credit the giver. Look at the principle. Credit the giver. Who is giving? Some people are giving. So we have to pay them back. That is why credit in the liabilities. Okay, so this is a basic logic, this you have to understand. Okay, so this is the basic. And then come to the trial balance now to pick the income. So this is income, sales is income, 5,25,000. But there is some sales return. Look at this, sales return is there. Sales return. What is sales return? Some goods we sold to customer, they are not satisfied with that, they have given it back. So our net revenue is 5,25,000 minus 15,000. That is equal to only how much? That is equal to? Please tell me how much?
Five lakh 5,000.
5 lakh 10,000. For that, I just prepared a note here. Since it is a small academic discussion, so we have only two items. But in real life, sales itself will be 5-10 items will be there. Sales return may be there 2-4 items. So like that, you have to do adjustment here, and the net amount of 5 lakh 10,000. I am just taking to this statement called profit and loss account, the first starting point, 5 lakh 10,000. Okay. On the examination of this trial balance, I come to know there is no other income. Since I have gone through, I am telling. If you want, you can just go through. So, see, these are all not income.
Sorry to interrupt, sir. So, while preparing this profit and loss account, what we are trying to do right now, so the note preparation is mandatory, sir, to do that, or can we prepare?
Yes. You have to write that note as well.
Okay, note preparation should be there. Okay, thanks.
So,
in the real life financial statements for companies, they also prepare the notes because there will be a lot of notes for them. In their financial statement, the notes will be there.
If they are not preparing, then why should we prepare? Since they are preparing, we are also preparing it.
Okay.
See, disclosure. Suppose you are a shareholder of this company. They are telling revenue from operation is 5 lakh 10,000. You are just wondering how this 5 lakh 10,000 has come. Disclosing. Sir, I have sold this many goods. I have got this much of return. So that balance is this much. So that is what? The notice. It is to be prepared. In real life also it is there. If you are having time, you just download the balance sheet and income statement of any company and you can see that it will be there. For example, you can take any company of listed companies. Okay. Right. So there is no other income. So I'm putting zero.
So sorry, the note number should be just random.
Yeah, note number starting is, you're right. Good question. No, note number, actually speaking, the balance sheet is the first statement. Accountingly, we have to prepare first statement of profit loss account, then the balance goes to a balance sheet. But presentation, balance sheet is the first statement they will present, and then next statement they will present the income statement or profit loss account. That is why the note number starts from the last number of the balance sheet. So what you do, you don't put a note number first. First, you prepare all the note, then last, you can put a note number. Note number first should be of balance sheet starting point first. Then what note number is the last note number in the balance sheet? The next note number is the first note number of income statement. Got it, sir?
Perfect, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. That is why I written 12 here. Okay. Right. All right. So this 5 lakh 10,000 is the total revenue. Now come to expenses. The first and foremost expense given in the format is material consumed. So what is material consumed? Material consumed is nothing but purchase of raw material. Please understand, this is raw material. Purchase of raw material opening stock of raw material plus purchase of raw material minus closing stock of raw material. I repeat. Opening stock of raw material plus purchase of raw material minus closing stock of raw material is equal to material consumed. Look at the word material. This is raw material only. There are companies which buy raw material and process it and sell it. Those companies, this entry will be definitely there. There are some companies, they don't buy any raw material. They buy the stock itself. They buy the goods itself. And they stock it and they just sell it. Those companies will not have any kind of item like this. Okay? Material consumed won't be there. They are not consuming anything. They just buy and sell. So in this question also, it is just buy and sell. So there is no opening stock of raw material. Purchase of raw material and the closing stock of raw material. So I'm putting zero. Okay. Next, purchase of stock in trade. This is nothing but the goods what the company buy and keep it and sell it. Okay, look at the trial balance. There is a purchase. Look at this purchase. There is a purchase. Amount is 2,10,000. Purchase is 2,10,000. Same time, look at this return. Purchase return is there. 20,000 is the purchase return. How do I know? Two returns are there. Returns are given, two side amount is given, debit and credit. Sales is always income, so credit side. Purchase is always expense, so debit side. Debit side. If purchase is debit side, purchase return should be credit side. If sales is credit side, sales return is opposite of that, so it should be debit side. So now sales is, sorry, purchase is 2,10,000 and the purchase return is 20,000. So the net amount is 1,90,000. Go to the note, 1,90,000. Note purchase. Look at this. Purchase of stock in trade. Purchase 2,10,000 given in the trial balance and the return, purchase return. Purchase return in the trial balance is 20,000. So it is minus 20,000. Okay. So, yeah, purchase minus. So 1,90,000 is the amount of money spent on buying of stock, which is available for sales.
Sir, sorry.
Yes.
So you just mentioned that this note should be created after the balance sheet is prepared, right? So why are we?
No. Note should be prepared simultaneously. Numbering you can give little later.
Okay. Got it. Okay.
Yeah, note should be prepared simultaneously. Without that note, you cannot come out with number.
Right. Got it. Yeah.
Yeah. Next, changes in inventories. Changes in inventories. Please understand here. Inventory we refer apart from raw material. Any other things are there in the company, we are calling it as inventory. In this particular case, change in inventory. What is change in inventory? Opening minus closing. Opening minus closing. Opening minus closing of inventory is called as change in inventory. Opening inventory minus closing inventory is called as change in inventory. Okay. While considering that opening and closing, you should not consider the opening of raw material and closing of raw material because that has been already taken into consideration while calculating materials consumed. Apart from materials consumed, what and all will be there in the company? Suppose you are a manufacturing company, you will buy material that is being considered here. Okay, but the material will be not completed immediately. It will be in work in progress. After that also, if it is finished goods, all of a sudden you cannot sell all the goods. There will be a stock. So stock of finished goods, stock of work in progress, both opening and closing. Keep in mind. Then one more thing is, if your company is also involved in just buying and selling of goods, this stock, this 1,90,000 rupees is the total amount you spent on buying the stock. But if closing stock is zero, you can simply say that all the goods what you bought is sold. Suppose closing stock is something like 10,000. That 10,000 is called as closing stock of stock in trade. Okay. So before you buy this stock in trade of 1,90,000, you already have some 20,000 worth of stock which was purchased in the last year but not sold in last year. It is going to be sold in the current year. So those items we have to take it here. That is called change in inventory. I repeat again, opening stock of finished goods, opening stock of work in progress, opening stock of stock in trade, all these total minus closing stock of finished goods, closing stock of work in progress and the closing stock of stock in trade is equal to change in inventory. It can be either plus or minus. If opening is greater than the closing, it will be plus. If closing is greater than the opening, it will be minus. Now let us look into the trial balance to find out the opening and the closing stock. Always opening stock will be there in the trial balance and closing stock will be there in the adjustment. So opening stock 65,000, closing stock 80,000. Look at this, 80,000. Opening stock and the closing stock. We don't know whether it is finished goods or stock or it is even stock. So it can be stock in trade. It can be closing stock in trade. Okay, for our better understanding. Opening stock in trade. So this company is a trading company. Okay. And here also you have to change this. just for more understanding. Okay, creating company. So it's buying stock and selling stock. That's all. It is not producing anything. It is not producing anything. Okay. If that is the case, opening is 65 and closing is 85. Closing is 80. So come to the note. Change in inventory. Okay. Opening stock 65,000. Closing stock 80,000. So the balance is 15,000 minus. I am bringing this to the statement. Minus 15,000. Got it? Minus 15,000. Next, employee benefit expenses. Next item is employee benefit expenses. All the expenses which are related to employees, employee benefit, employee payment, will be grouped under one category. That category is called as employee benefit expense. Come to the trial balance. Building is not an expense. Fund is not an expense. Fixed wage is an expense. Wage is an expense, right? Wage is employee benefit expense. Keep in mind, wage. Next, salary.
Salary.
Okay, that's all. Wage and salary. Come to the table, come to the note. Note number 15, employee benefit expenses. So wage and salary, 30,000 and 60,000, total is 90,000. Here you have to make one point very clear. In the trial balance, it is given, two items are given, wage and salary is given. So you take it. Suppose in the adjustment here, EFG, suppose in the G point, there is one point, outstanding salary, our salary is still payable, rupees 5,000, if it is given like this, in this statement, you have to add 5,000. Salary plus outstanding salary, 5,000 rupees. You have to add, then your total salary will become 65, total employee benefit will become 95,000. Clear? If there is any outstanding expenses are there, you have to add like that. Suppose prepaid is there. I think this is there. We will discuss that time. Prepaid is there. You have to minus. Okay. So now it is to be written in the employee benefit expenses, 90,000 rupees. Employee benefit expense, 90,000. Salary and wages, 30 plus 60, 90,000.
95,000.
Okay. Any point to be?
Is it 95,000, sir? We have paid outstanding salary.
Sorry, sir?
It's 95,000 also. We have well.
No. I'm just telling. If it is there, I'm telling.
Okay.
I'm telling. I'm teaching that.
Sure.
If there is any point of outstanding, I would add. If nothing is there, I take as it is.
Got it, sir.
Yeah. Next point is finance cost. Any expenditure related to interest on bank loan, interest on debenture, interest on any loan, bank charges, any amount what you are paying in order to use some kind of debt, use some kind of loan, that is called the finance cost. Look into the trial balance. Is there any finance cost available? Yeah, there is an interest. Interest on debenture is there. 14,000 rupees. If it is only one item, there is no need of note. No need of preparing a note. Interest on debenture. There is no need of preparing a note. So next item in the profit and loss account is depreciation and amortization. What is depreciation and how do we calculate? What is amortization? The value of fixed asset which need to be charged to the current year income is called depreciation. If that is on fixed asset, it is depreciation. If that is on intangible asset, that is called amortization. land value, what is the difference between the opening and the closing? Not about market value, please don't confuse. Market value is different from this concept what we are discussing. See, suppose you bought a particular machine, the particular machine. In my same example, beginning I told you 10 lakh rupees, you bought a machine. You are estimating this machine can be used for 10 years effectively. If so, you cannot charge all the 10 lakh rupees into a profit and loss account of one particular year because it is going to be used for 10 years. So 1 year usage, the cost of 1 year usage is only 1 lakh. This 1 lakh is called depreciation. But today, according to your book, the value of the machine, book value of the machine is, after the 1 year, the book value of the machine is?
9 lakhs.
How much?
9 lakhs.
According to the books, the book value of the asset after 1 year is 9 lakh. But it does not necessarily to be the market value of the asset should be also 9 lakh. The market value after 1 year may be 920,000 or maybe 880,000. That depends. Depends on the buyer and seller. You are the seller, the buyer left to them. Okay. So this amount is called depreciation. If this is a machine, it is called depreciation. If it is of patent, good trademark, or any other copyright, something like that, that is called amortization. Sir, both are same. Yeah.
Yes, sorry, sir. Depreciation. When we are talking about that 1 lakh, so where will we find that percentage of depreciation? It will be given.
We have a logic to calculate. How do we calculate this 1 lakh? We have a lot of methods to calculate. Straight line method, diminishing balance method. There are a lot of methods are available. Depending upon the asset, depending upon the company law, we have to apply the appropriate method of depreciation to calculate the amount of depreciation or to calculate the percentage of depreciation. Okay. Actually, amount of depreciation divided by value of the asset into 100 is equal to percentage of depreciation. But that is not the subject matter of in this class. In this class, you will be given with the amount of depreciation or the percentage of depreciation. How do we find out the percentage? How do we find out that amount is depending upon two aspects. One is the nature of the asset. Another one is the law governing your business. Company law says, see, it's very important. Depreciation is very important. If you charge more depreciation, what will happen to the net profit? If you charge
lesser profit. Yeah.
So always the companies make, but it is not the amount spent. Look at that. Depreciation is not the actual amount spent today. It was the amount spent long ago. From that, we are minusing certain amount. So it's not an out-of-pocket expense. It is just a book entry. From the asset, it is transferred to the depreciation. Then again, it is transferred to P&L account. So if you charge more and more depreciation, you will be able to show lesser profit, which will result in the lesser tax. So government always wants to have an eye on this. So government is giving you the method of depreciation, what is to be followed for a particular asset. There is no uniform method available. If you are a soft drink manufacturer, soft drink company, suppose Coke, okay. The bottles, the non-disposable bottles are there, no? Returned bottles. Bottles are the fixed asset for Coke company, bottles, okay? I'm not talking about the use and throw can, bottle. So bottle, if you charge depreciation on diminishing balance method, the straight line method, every year 10% of the bottle amount is going to be considered as depreciation. At the end of the 10th year, the bottle will be remaining there, but the value of the bottle will be zero according to your book value. So that is not correct. Okay. So government has already decided on what asset, what method of depreciation should be applied and what percentage to be applied according to company side. And again, one more point, please understand very clearly in this stage, every company will prepare two profit and loss account. One is according to company side to pay dividend or something. Okay. Another one is according to Income Tax Act. Company Act preparation of profit and loss account is more relating to accounting principles. But income tax act is more worry about reporting of correct income, because income tax department will collect the income tax, corporate tax, profit. How much is there on that profit? Certain 33.33% as corporate tax payable to the government of India, all companies. So income tax department is very much worried about this amount of correct calculation. So for that, certain expenditure will not be allowed by income tax department to be minused from your income, certain expenditure. And certain income should be considered by the company to calculate your total income according to Income Tax Act. So Income Tax Act will be more worried about the correct calculation of your profit after profit before tax, this amount. Profit before tax, this amount. Profit before tax. Okay. So now what we are discussing is according to Companies Act. According to Companies Act. Got it? According to Companies Act. So Companies Act is saying what amount of depreciation should be charged on what kind of asset. So you don't worry about that. That is a different aspect of discussion, concept of depreciation. Now you will be given with depreciation. Look at this question. Depreciation. Depreciation is given in the question. Depreciate buildings. That's what I'm telling. The managers will decide this. The legal compliance, chartered accountant, the auditors will decide all these things. They know how much is to be charged on a particular asset. Okay. So 2% is on building and 5% on furniture. That's what given to us. So now go to the trial balance. Where is building? Building is 1,80,000. 1,80,000. On this 1,80,000, what's the percentage? 2%. So 1,80,000, 2%. And furniture. Where is furniture? Yeah, furniture is 80,000. On this 80,000, you have to calculate 5%. So just calculate and total the depreciation in the note. Okay, and one more depreciation is given in the question, that is write-off goodwill. That is amortization. Write-off goodwill. Look at this. Write-off 10% of goodwill. Write-off 10% of goodwill. So goodwill is how much? Look at the goodwill. Goodwill is, where is goodwill?
Goodwill.
I'll tell you. Where is goodwill?
Sir, so scroll down.
In the next page, sir.
Next page.
Goodwill. So, on this goodwill, how much they told? 10%. So, 10% of this is 5,200. So, 5,200 plus that furniture goodwill plus furniture depreciation plus depreciation on building. So, 2% on 1,80,000, 5% on 80,000, and 10% on 52,000. These are all the three items of write off. Depreciation and then amortization. Total of this is 12,800 is the value of amortization and depreciation expenses to be minused from the total income. Now somebody asked, what is goodwill? Anybody in the class would like to answer? Yes, sir. Anybody? Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yes. Okay. So nobody wants to say or something. Okay. According to me, goodwill is nothing but, okay, let me just say, of course, we don't have time, just anyway, one point. Is goodwill good for the company?
Yes, sir, it is good for the company.
Yes.
Then, without knowing what is goodwill, how can you say it's good for the company? I was asking you what is goodwill, you are not telling anything. Okay, just to justify. Just to justify why goodwill is good for the company.
It is more like the company is doing good in terms of profit and it's got a value on the application basis on that.
Slowly, come again.
Maybe the company is doing good in terms of profits and also in terms of reputation. Basis
so
on
the company
that.
Company is doing good in terms of business. Normally, it will have more profit. That's all, no?
Yeah.
Then where from goodwill comes in? You have returned something. Look at this statement. You return goodwill as 52,000. So how do we decide this 52,000 is the goodwill? I'm doing every year good profit. That is going to be in profit and loss account, no? Look at this. That is there in the profit and loss account. Where is profit and loss account? Yeah. Profit and loss account. It is not there. I'm not
there.
Yes, sir. Yeah. The company has earned so far a profit of 27,000 rupees up to now. Then why you want to record separately? If I want to record myself goodwill, I can record more goodwill in my company, no? How
it's
this amount comes into account? According to me, goodwill is not good for the company. You may wonder what is
no.
the gentleman is telling, something other way around. You might have understood so far, goodwill is the reputation of a company. Goodwill is the good name of the company. The very name itself, goodwill. Goodwill. Everybody is thinking good about you. That's what goodwill, no?
So goodwill is intangible asset which cannot be claimed when a company buys another company and it buys.
Yeah, that's very great, good, very good. So this gentleman has understood correctly the concept of goodwill in terms of accounting. According to accounting, whatever I understand, goodwill is not good for the company when it is there in the books of account. Now this company is having goodwill of 52,000 rupees. How it might have emerged, I'll tell you, how it might have emerged. Suppose A Limited is trying to buy B Limited. A Limited buys B Limited. B Limited is telling, okay, sir, I will give my business only for 1 lakh. Only for 1 lakh. If you give me 1 lakh, I'll give you my running business as it is to you. I'll hand over my business and I'll quit. A Limited can run the business from today onwards, B Limited as well. Okay. Now, A Limited is analyzing the financial status of B Limited. So in B Limited, the total assets are equal to 90,000. But the total asset means the asset available to the owner. Okay, total asset minus external liability is equal to 90,000 rupees. That's called net worth of the business. But now B Limited is asking you to pay how much? 1 lakh. But A Limited is going to get the asset of B Limited if it buys B Limited only worth of 90,000 rupees. But A Limited is very keen about the buying of this what corporate merger, acquisition. Okay, just a simple example I've taken. Okay, A Limited acquires B Limited for the payment of 1 lakh rupee. But at the same time, B Limited surrenders its asset, which is worth rupees only 90,000 net assets. It may surrender a lot of assets, which may worth more than 90. But A Limited has to pay to the creditors of B Limited later on behalf of B Limited, because B Limited is no longer exist hereafter. This merger is done. Now, in the books of A Limited, what is the entry you will make? What is happening in A Limited? A Limited gets asset of 90,000 rupees and gives a payment of 1 lakh rupee. So what are the two accounts affected? Assets account debit, according to your double entry bookkeeping. Debit what comes in? Assets are coming in. How much worth of assets are coming in?
90,000
worth of assets are coming in. How much amount is going out?
1 lakh.
1 lakh.
Full cash account, 1 lakh is going out. according to double entry bookkeeping, each and every debit should have its own corresponding equal debit. Credit should have debit and debit should have credit, but it is mismatching. Look at this. Normally speaking, layman's point of view, you are buying 90,000 worth of assets by paying
one lakh rupees.
So it is 10,000 rupees excess you are paying.
Yes.
That excess only you are writing it as goodwill account. So when I will be doing this, when I will be ready to pay 1 lakh rupee to buy an asset worth rupees 90,000. Are you able to understand this logic? Asset comes in 90,000 rupees worth for the payment of 1 lakh rupee. So the difference between the asset value and the payment value, I'm taking it as liability, I mean goodwill. When the A Limited is ready to pay 1 lakh rupee, which is more than the asset value what is receiving, when it will be ready to pay?
Because the worth of the assets is more than 90,000, sir. He feels that...
No, it is valued. The asset is valued for 90,000 only. Today's the market value of the asset is 90,000.
So he feels there is a potential to grow. So
there is a potential. See, B Limited is already existing. Customer knows about B Limited. There are existing customers for B Limited. Board is not to be established again. Already customers are there, business is there, everything is established. If A Limited wants to open up a new branch in some new places, it need to give advertisement, it need to create customer base, it need to do so many things. The preliminary work it has to do. But instead of doing all those things, you are getting a readily established business. For that purpose, you are ready to give some amount more than the asset what you are acquiring. That is what goodwill is. So this goodwill is good for the selling company. Selling company gets 10,000 rupees more than the worth of the asset what it is selling. It is good. But for
so, sir, in the statement of... So,
sorry?
Yes. Yeah, so for A, it is written as goodwill. But for B, where will that extra 10,000 which he receives will be put? In which tab?
Now, B Limited is there?
If he is in some other entity, means if he has sold...
Now B Limited is there before you give 1 lakh. On the giving of 1 lakh, B Limited ceases to be existing, right? So this all 1 lakh rupee, all 1 lakh rupee cash will be there. Instead of asset, there will be only one asset, that is cash of 1 lakh rupee, right? B Limited will be having only one asset, that is cash.
Cash.
All other assets are given to A Limited. Now B Limited is there only with name as well as only one item of asset, that is cash.
Cash.
Are you getting my point?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. This all the 1 lakh rupee will be distributed to the shareholder of the company according to their shareholding pattern.
Huh.
This 90,000 itself is the net asset. It is not total asset. Net asset. The company may have 2 lakh worth of asset. In that 2 lakh worth of asset, we are going more deviated, but anyway. 2 lakh worth of asset the company was having. Land, building, cash, bank account, stock, machinery, etc., etc. Full worth rupees, 2 lakh. That is total asset. Total asset. There are some liabilities, external liabilities. There are some external liabilities, which are to be payable is 1,10,000. It is paid. Remaining asset, remaining only, is 90,000. This is being taken by A Limited from B Limited. Okay. Total asset is 2 lakh. External liability is to be payable by A Limited on behalf of B Limited is 1,10,000. So the net result enjoyed by the A Limited in the business of B Limited is only 90,000. Now they are giving 1 lakh. What will happen to this 1 lakh? This 1 lakh will be shared by all the shareholder of that company, depending upon their shareholding pattern. Suppose there are 10 rupee share, 5,000 shareholders are there. Okay, this will be divided by 5,000. And suppose I have 2 shares, the amount of per share into 5 share I will take. That is called distribution of cash to the shareholder at the last on the liquidation. Got it, sir?
Yes, sir. Very clear. Thank you.
So this is something about goodwill. Now the IFRS will tell you how do you recognize this goodwill. This is just an example, the basic point I told you. But IFRS will tell you how do you value this 90,000. This 90 is a market value, I told you. So IFRS will tell you how do I get this 90,000. It's very subjective. Market value is very subjective, right? So how do I recognize that 90,000? How do I arrive that 90,000? For that we have some logic. Okay, now come to goodwill. Goodwill is 52,000, 10% of that is 5,200. Put all these together, we got 12,800. Next, other expenses. Apart from these A, B, C, D, E, F, everything is other expenses. Apart from these A, B, C, D, E, F, is there any expense? All other things are called other expense. Look at this. Not an expense. Tell me the expense. I'm just going one by one. Tell me the expense. Yeah. Director fee is an expense.
Yes. Employee.
Keep in mind, director fee is an expense. Freight is an expense. Trading expense is an expense. Audit fee is an expense. Preliminary expense is an expense. Insurance and tax is an expense. Only take insurance. Don't confuse. Insurance. That's the old usage. Insurance and taxes.
Printing and stationery.
Printing and stationery. So these are all expenses. Look at this. All expenses. I bring this into a note. Other expenses. Director fee, freight, trading expenses. Trading expenses, audit fee. Insurance. Look at this insurance. Insurance was given in the question as total amount paid as insurance for this 1 year is 20,000 rupees. But in the adjustment, they are telling you insurance was prepaid rupees 1,500. What is prepaid? You paid for next year. So if you take all the amount paid in the current year as an expense in the current year, that will misguide the profit. That is called charging more expense in the today in the current year. That is not correct. You have to charge the expense of current year only in the current year income. So this 1,500 is there. Next year, prepaid means what? We still have the time to enjoy the benefit. We paid in advance. So you have to minus that to calculate the correct expense of current year. So insurance, 20,000 rupees paid, but 1,500 is still for the next year. So the net insurance amount of the current year is 18,500 only. Okay. Next, preliminary expenses. Given in the question is 60,000 rupees. What is preliminary expense, anybody?
Is it miscellaneous expenditure?
Sorry?
Is it a miscellaneous expenditure?
No.
That is different, right?
Preliminary expense are those expenditure which are incurred in the beginning of the company's
incorporation. Okay, yeah. Yes. Beginning of the company.
Yeah, beginning, before the company starts, to just create a company, incorporation expense, legal expense, registration expense, all those things put together is called preliminary expense. Okay. This expenditure is not for the current year only. The company is created out of this expense. So this expense is going to give me the benefit for longer period of time. But I cannot keep it as an asset always. It need to be written off. Meaning it need to be charged to income. It need to be minused from income gradually. If I do all the 60,000 minus from current year income, current year profit will be very less. That is illogical because the 60,000 rupees spent in the current year in the terms of preliminary expense is not only for the current year benefit. It is for the longer year benefit. So the management will decide how much percentage of the preliminary expense need to be charged from the current year income. That is given in the question, write off 25% of preliminary expenses. That means 25% of the total preliminary expense need to be minus from the income of current year. Remaining 75% will be there in the balance sheet, that to be written off in the next coming years, the next 3 years. At the end of fourth year, preliminary expense in the balance sheet will become zero. Thereafter, there won't be any expenditure to be minused from income in the name of preliminary expenses. Got it? So 25% of preliminary expense of 60 is equal to 15,000. That 15 will come under other expense in the name of preliminary expenses, 15,000. That means 25% of 60,000. Any doubt? Next, printing and stationery. Another expense. It is given 15,000, so I am taking 15,000. So total of this is going to be 98,000. 20, 30, 35, 50, 60, 78, 500, 83, 500, 93, 500, 98, 500. Okay, 98, 500. If you have check it, cross check it. 30, 35, 60, 75, yeah, 90, 98, 500. So 98, 500 should be recorded in the name of other expenses. 98, 500. Next, we have to talk about the total expense. Total 98,500 is the other expense. Total expense means the total of A, B, C, D, E, F, G, all these total. All these total. Total of all these things. 1,90,000 minus 15 plus 90 plus 14 plus 12, 800, 98,500. Somebody calculator, tell me, is it correct total? 8 plus 5, 13, 9, 11, 15, 15 minus 5, 0. So 0, 1, 10, 11, 12, 12 minus 1, 11, 11 plus 9, 20, 20 plus 1, 21, plus 2. Is it correct? Somebody just calculate it, tell me. Quickly.
It's correct, sir.
Correct?
All right. Correct.
Thank you. So total expense. So from total income, you have to minus the total expenditure. That is 5,10,000 minus 5,10,000 minus 3,90,300. How much?
1,19,700
is the profit before tax. Since in this question no tax is there, and just to, it is, it does not mean that this company should not pay tax. We don't think about that. That is why we are ignoring that. If it is there, you have to minus the tax, which is the net profit available for the company to distribute. Yeah.
So if there is a tax, it will only affect only reflect in PA. Sir, if there is tax, it will only reflect in PL account, right? Or not in balance sheet?
Yes, it will affect the PL account. See, you will write it here.
Okay, okay.
It's suppose tax, in the question it is given tax somewhere, you will take that amount and you will write it in this zero. This zero won't be there, this amount will be there.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Now this is the profit and loss account. 10 minutes break, then we'll come here and do the balance sheet. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. I just pause for 10 minutes. Okay, are you all there? Can we start? Am I audible? Can we start now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Before we proceed with the balance sheet, somebody raised a question in the chat box. That is Nina. Sir, can you please explain about investment in equity share and raising fund from general public? Anybody would like to take up this question and answer? Raising money from public and investing in equity share.
Yes, sir. Sir, I'm Nina here.
Okay, yeah. What exactly you want to know?
Sir, not now, sir. After the end of the class, you can explain to us, sir.
Definitely, I'll do that.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
So just remind me before we close it, I'll tell you.
Sure, sir.
Okay, let us finish this balance sheet. So next is balance sheet of so-and-so company as on a particular day. That is the heading you have to take, balance sheet of Detergent Company Limited. As on 31st 3 2020, it is given in the question. The trial balance is on 31 3 2020, so the same date only we are preparing the balance sheet, the same date, right? This company is having a share capital of 20,000 shares and 100 rupees each one share is equal to 100 rupees. That's the registered capital. Okay, this company is issued only 3,000 shares at the rate of 100 each, so 3 lakh rupees. And some people who have taken the shares did not pay the money still. That is calls in arrear. Okay. Calls in arrear. Actually, since that girl was also asking, the concept also here, I'll tell you. Suppose you want to start a company. Okay. Only public limited company can raise money from general public. Public limited company only can raise money from public. How they raise money from public? They raise money from public through IPO. What is IPO? After getting due permission from government, called SEBI, Securities and Exchange Board of India, they give advertisement. They give all the information about the company through prospectus. Through prospectus, they will give the information to the general public. Then those who are interested to buy the share, they will have to apply. If you have a bank account, okay, in the bank account, you'll be having an option called IPO subscription. Through that, you can apply. For this, from the company point of view, you have to take a permission from SEBI. How many shares you are issuing, at what rate you are going to collect, all those things company will decide. In consultation with SEBI, they will just come up with the number of shares to be issued, number of shares. In this company, 20,000 shares the company has taken a permission. 20,000 shares the company has taken a permission from SEBI to issue. This is called registered capital, allowed capital. Maximum amount of shares the company can issue is 20,000 shares. Face value of 100 rupees. 20,000 shares of rupees 100 each as face value. Okay. Now, the company need not to issue all the shares. What do you mean by issue? Selling the shares and getting the money. Selling share means it is not selling anything. It is just giving a paper. It is taking money from the public and giving a paper. That is called issue of share or selling of shares. Okay. Now, all the 20,000 shares, if you sell for 100 rupees, you will get the total amount of 20,000 into 100. But the company is very initial stage, it does not want all those money, okay, immediately. It does not want all those money immediately. Though the registered capital is 20,000 shares, it is ready to collect money only for 3,000 shares. Look at this, 3,000 shares. Remaining, it can collect money later. That time, it need not go again to SEBI to take a permission. For that purpose only, it has already taken a permission up to 20,000 shares. Now, time being, it is issuing 3,000 shares for rupees 100 each. Okay. This 100 rupees is the price of one equity share. 100 rupees is the price of one equity share. Face value. Face value means the value given or returned in the face of the equity share. Nominal value, face value, or original value, like that you can call them. But in reality, what will happen? They will sell more than the face value. They will fix some premium. They will fix some premium. Premium. Who will be fixing this? Suppose the company is already there in the market doing business, but not a public limited company. It can be a private limited company, or it could be a partnership, whatever it is. Now only it is going to public to raise money after getting permission from SEBI. Okay. If that is the case, it's a running business. Business is already there. Only the form is going to be different. It will approach merchant banker. You know, merchant banker. The issuing company, say for example, our Burger King, assume. This is the issuing company. It's already having a business. It's already doing it. It wants money now from the general public. It wants to collect money. That time it approaches SEBI and takes necessary permission to issue shares. That is 20,000 shares. For one share is equal to 10 rupees each as a face value. Now, the company which is issuing the shares will approach a merchant banker. Merchant banker is a financial intermediary. It will be approaching merchant banker to value the company. To value the issuing company. Okay, the company will be valued by the merchant banker by applying some appropriate technique. Then they will come out with the price of the shares. Please understand, the 100 is not the price of the share. The 100 is the face value of the share. Face value. Okay, face value. But price of the share will be determined by the merchant banker by taking into account your business prospects, your existing business, your past history and everything. Put together, they will find out the price of the share. They will not tell one X amount or Y amount. They will say some range. Say for example, 120 to 125. The worst case, the company share price is 120. The best case, the company share price is 125. Now it is announced to the public. The public will decide at what rate they want to buy. Okay. If they want to buy 125, the company is allotting at 125. If there are no people to buy at 125, then they will be going for the next possible option, 124 or 123. It will be open in the market for 1 week or 3 days or 4 days like that. 3 days, it will be open. Issue open and issue close. That time, now as an individual, I have to open my bank account, my net banking account. In that, I can just go there and I can give IPO subscription. Normally, they will be having a lot. They will be having a lot system. What is lot system? Lot will be there. Lot means, suppose 15 share is equal to 1 lot. Okay, minimum you have to buy 5 lot or 3 lots or 1 lot. Like that, they will be giving. So you are applying to this company during this 3 days between these prices. It's just like an auctioning. This is called book building. Auctioning only. The merchant banker is telling the indicative price of the share. It is you. It is the public. It is the market decides what is the price, exact price. From 120 to 125. This is called price band. Price band. This is floor price. This is cap price. Highest, lowest. Now, within these 3 days, everybody will apply online through bank account. And fourth day, they will just open. How many people have asked for the shares? How many shares I am issuing? I am issuing only 3,000 shares. If I receive application for more than 3,000 shares, I have to reject some applications and I have to allot only for 3,000 shares. Okay. Then the highest bidder, suppose 125, if I decide the selling price, if I am able to sell all the 3,000 shares, then my selling price of the share is 125. No, sir, if I decide 125, the people asking is only 2,500. That time I cannot fix 125 as my price. I have to compromise. I have to come down. Then 124, if I take 125 as the price, how many people are ready to buy? Sir, more than 3,000. Then you can decide 124 is the price of the share. That is the allotment price. Then the very next day it is coming to the listing. Okay, the listing day, the market will decide the price of the particular share on the particular day. It may go more than 124 or it may come less than 124 also. So that is called issue price. Then next is called listing price. If listing price is more, what will happen? Listing price is more. What will happen? More than the issue price.
Share price will go up.
You'll get profit. If you want to sell, you'll get profit. If listing price is less than the issue price, then loss. So you won't sell the share, you'll keep it for later period. Now in Burger King, the listing price is almost double the time than that of the issue price. Okay. So if you are a promoter of a company, if you are a entrepreneur of a company, first you have to consult a particular financial intermediary to help you with all these prospects, all this process. No entrepreneur will be able to do all this process on its own. Okay, so you have to approach a person, but this is a process. First, you have to register your company as a public limited company in Register of Companies under Indian Companies Act. Then you have to prepare prospectus. Then you have to approach SEBI for asking permission for collecting money from the general public. Then SEBI will give a permission for how much shares you can collect, at what rate. This what rate means it's a face value. Depending upon your company's performance, this face value may be going up. This is called a premium. This 20 is called premium. 25 is called premium. Okay, that is being determined by a valuer. That valuer is called a merchant banker. Merchant banker will take care of all legal formalities, all other things to help a company, because you will be busy in production. You'll be busy in your business aspects, your business strategy and all. You will not be good in legal formalities. So merchant banker will do that and they will help you in this process. Then finally, they will tell you, sir, this is the price, you can sell the shares. Yes, then you are selling it. Then the shares will be credited to their demat account. Who bought it? Then they can either keep the share with them or they can sell the share immediately after they buy, depending upon the profit or their strategy of investment. This is what normally happening in the primary market. This we call it as primary market. If you take a finance as a specialization, in the third semester you may study this. Okay, financial markets investment. Okay, now come to this company. 20,000 share was a permission given to this company, but this company has issued only 3,000 shares. Yeah, one more point I want to tell here. This 125 rupees is there now. Suppose if 125 is the issue price. Those days, how it was collected? Nowadays, it is collected all together. Only one lump sum it is collected. But those days, how it is collected means three, four stages it will be collected. Three, four stages. First stage is application stage. Say for example, 25 rupees. Then allotment stage, another some amount from 50 rupees. Then 75 is over. Then first and final call, maybe 75 rupees. They will collect like this, stages. This may be in the 2019, this may be in 2020, this may be in 2021, depending upon the company's requirement of money. Okay. like that it was, but now it is collected together, collected together. Okay, application money, allotment money, first call and final call. In this question, it is an old question, so this calls in arrear is there. How, what is calls in arrear? Suppose this is the call, this is called call money, 75 rupees you have to pay to the company once it is asked for, once it is asked for. Okay, after payment of 25, 50 and 75, totally it is, I'm sorry, 50 rupees, no? 50 rupees. So after payment of these three stages, you need not to pay any money to the company, even though the company is in profit, the company is in loss. That is called limited liability. Now, there is a shareholder who applied and paid application money, After that, he was allotted the share and he paid the allotment of the allotment money also. But after that, he did not pay the final call, first and final call. Some company will have 2-3 stages, first call, second call, and the final call. He did not pay his 50 rupees. That is called calls in arrear. You sent a letter to the shareholder instructing that pay 50 rupees per share within this date. But he did not pay that money within that date. That is called calls in arrear. So really speaking, though you intended to collect 3 lakh rupees from the public, you collected only 2,84,000 only, because 16,000 rupees is still to come. That is called calls in arrear. Okay, so now we have to see the trial balance for all the assets, liabilities, and equity. Then only we can prepare a trial balance. Balance sheet. So balance sheet format is known to you. I have given you the last class itself. This is a balance sheet format. Equity and liability, shareholder fund, share capital, resource and surplus, non-current liability, current liability. Total of that is called total of assets, total of equity and liability. Then asset side total. Current assets, non-current assets. Okay. We'll take one by one from the trial balance. Already we have taken a trial balance, no? Marked trial balance is there. So we can easily find out which item is left out. So this item is left out. So it is a balance sheet item. Equity share capital. Bring that equity share capital. Equity share capital. How much it was? 3 lakh it was. Look at this. Are you understanding? 3 lakh it was. 3 lakhs. Sorry. 3 lakhs. But the 16,000 is not collected. So net amount is only 2,84,000. That is what it is written here. 2,84,000. Look at this note number. If this call scenario is not there, directly I will write 3 lakh rupees in share capital. Any doubt up to this?
No, sir.
Yeah. So share capital. Next, resource and surplus. For resource and surplus, I have to prepare a note. Come to note. Before that, I have to tell you how this profit is being managed, how the profit is being apportioned. That is profit and loss appropriation. Look at this. In the trial balance, you already have 27,000 rupees as a balance of last year profit and loss. Last year profit and loss, 27,000. Look at this. Last year profit and loss is 27,000 rupees. Last year. Current year profit is 1,19,700. So these are the total profit available in the company for distributing these two shareholders. Look at this. These two I have taken. These two are the profit available in the company as of now, 31/3/2020, which is available for distribution to the owners, to the shareholders. But there is an instruction to us from the company. Look at this. From the company, there is an instruction. What is the instruction? It is given here. Transfer 60,000 rupees to reserve. Transfer to reserve fund 60,000 rupees. From the profit, we have to take 60,000 rupees and keep it as a reserve. That's information. That's instruction. Already the company is having some reserve. Look at this. Already the company is having some reserve. the company is having some reserve, 2,50,000. Already it is there. Along with the 2,50,000, we take this 25,000. 2,50,000 is already there. Now from the current year, we are taking 60,000 rupees. So this 60,000 rupees should be minused from the current year profit. 60,000 rupees. Where is it? Yeah, 60,000 rupees. It should be minused 60,000 rupees. Okay. And look into the question. Still some more information regarding these profit appropriations. Look at this. The director is proposing 25% of capital as dividend. Okay. 25% of paid up capital as dividend. What is paid up capital? Paid up capital is nothing but this amount. Paid up capital. That 16,000 is unpaid. Totally 3 lakh to be paid. 16 is unpaid. So 2,84,000 is paid up. On this 2,84,000, how much percentage? 25% as dividend. Total dividend of 25%. So 25% on 2,84,000. Somebody calculate 25% on 2,84,000. 25% on 2,84,000. Quickly.
71,000, sir.
71,000?
Yes. That's
71,000 I have written here. Look at this. 71,000 I have written here. Okay, 71,000 is the proposed dividend. Okay. One more point in the trial balance. Look at that. In the trial balance, there is an interim dividend. Look at this. There's an interim dividend. Already I have paid dividend to the shareholder. 21,368. On the 21,368, I paid tax to the government of India on behalf of the shareholder, 3,632. The total of this is becoming 25,000. So dividend expense to the company is 25,000. So I have promised to give 71. I already given 25. Okay, already given 25. So remaining payable is 46. Are you getting my point? 71,000 is the total dividend payable by the company. That's a proportion given by the company. Already they have given 25,000 as dividend. So remaining payable is 46,000. So from the total profit of 1,46,700, 25 is already paid, 46 is to be payable, and 60,000 is transferred to reserve. So remaining profit will be 1,46,700 minus these three is equal to 15,700 is the balance in the name of resource and surplus. 15,700 to be taken to resource and surplus. Where is it? 15,700. Already we have a reserve of 2,50,000 opening balance. Current year reserve is 60,000. So total reserve to be 3,10,000. Okay. Surplus is 15,700. So total resource and surplus. Resource and surplus is equal to 3,25,700. That is what we are writing here. 3,25,700. I repeat again. Reserve and surplus. Reserve is something taken from profit and kept it for some purpose. Surplus is just profit. Just profit. Left out profit. Undistributed profit. Unappropriated profit. Okay. So reserve up to the last year was 2,50,000. Current year reserve, what you are creating is 60,000. So totally it is 3,10,000. 3,10,000 is the reserve. Okay. Then what is surplus? Surplus is nothing but the left out amount in the profit of the company. Last year surplus is 27,000. This year surplus, before we do all this adjustment of transfer to reserve transfer to dividend is 1,19,700. So 1,19,700 plus the previous year profit put together is 1,46,700. This is the total surplus actually. If you don't have any dividend, if you don't have any transfer to reserve, this is the total surplus. But from this surplus, we have some reductions. We have some reductions. That is dividend paid and a dividend payable and a transfer to reserve. So totally it is 25 plus 46 plus 60 minus from 1,46,700. That is equal to 15,700. So 15,700 is the surplus alone, and we have reserve also put together is 1,25,700. Okay. Then borrowings. Next item is borrowings. Look at the trial balance. Left out item only you can check it. Borrowings. This is not borrowing. This is not. Yeah, this is borrowing. Look at this fixed deposit actually will be debit side. If that is the case, it's an asset. But here it is in the liability side. That means it is a borrowings. Credit. Look at this. Credit, I told you, credit means what? Credit means either liability or income. So it's a liability. So this 1 lakh is liability. And debenture is also there. This 1 lakh and this 1 lakh put together is loan. But 2 lakh is coming here. 2 lakh. Are you getting? Am I going too fast? No, right? 2 lakh is the total borrowings. For that, you prepared a note. Note number 3. Total borrowings. Okay. Next item in the balance sheet.
Sorry, sir. This is fixed deposit. How it will become liability? I mean,
you have taken fixed deposit from public. Suppose you are depositing 10 lakh rupee in the bank. For the bank, it is liability or asset?
For the bank, it is liability.
Similarly, this company, this detergent company, has accepted deposit from the public. Due permission from SEBI, companies can also accept fixed deposit.
Okay, sir, got it. Thank you.
That is why it is in. See, how do I know? I also don't know. It is given in the credit side, so I'm treating it as a liability.
Okay.
If it is in debit side, I'll put it in asset side. That's all.
Got it, sir. Got it.
Yeah. Then next one is current liability. There is no short term liability, so 0. Okay. Short term borrowing means for 1 month, 2 months, if you take a bank loan, that will come here. Then trade payables. Trade payables are nothing but the sundry creditors and the bills payable. Look at this. Yeah, bills payable. This is bills payable. The amount is 90,000. This 61 is bills receivable. Okay, that we will take for asset. And then sundry creditors. Yeah, creditors are there. This amount. Okay. So 1,50,000 and then how much? 1,50,000. Go to the note. Yeah. 1,50,000 and 90,000. 1,50,000 and 90. Total is equal to 2,40,000. These 240 comes under trade payables. Okay. Other current liability is not there, so I left it 0. Okay. Then short term provisions. Short term provisions means something which need to be paid immediately in the short period of time. That is short term provisions. We have this interim dividend. The proposed dividend. Proposed dividend is there now. Out of 71, we paid already 25. We did not pay 46. That 46 is still payable. Okay. That is 46,000. 46,000 is the short-term provisions, dividend payable. So the total. You have to take a total of this. Total of all liabilities. 2,84,000 plus 3,25,700 plus 2 lakh plus 2,40,000 plus 46 should be equal to 10,95,000. Check it. 700, 6, 10, 5. Remaining one, 5, 19. So 5, 9, 17, 19. Remaining one, 5, 8, 10. So 10,95,700. Come to asset side of the balance sheet, asset side. This is the format, non-current asset, under that fixed asset, then tangible and intangible. The non-current investments, long-term advances given. See, here, long-term advances, here also there, no? Long-term advances. This is what we have taken. This is what we have given. If you have given any advance to others, that's asset for us. So one by one. First, tangible asset. Look at the trial balance. Always trial balance is the base for us. So trial balance. Can you tell me what's the first item of tangible asset?
Building, sir.
Yeah, building. That's a left out item. First item is building. So building first. Building, then
machinery, furniture.
Machine, then furniture. Furniture. That's all. Okay. So come to the note. In that depreciation is there. You have to minus that. That's why note. Note number 6, tangible asset. Tangible asset. Building. It was given the
sorry, land is there, land will also come in tangible
sorry?
Asset. If land is there in the example, means current is not there.
Which one?
Land.
Yeah, yeah. Land, building, machine, plant, equipment, yeah. Furniture, computer, motor van, lorry, everything. All yeah. Tangible assets, fixed assets. Okay. So building is 1,80,000. You remember already we have taken depreciation of 3,600. That yes. Much value is reduced. Okay. In machinery, there is no depreciation given, so we are not minusing anything. In furniture, we have some depreciation, 5%. So 5% of depreciation, 4,000. So 1,80,000 minus 360 is equal to this. Total amount of tangible asset. Total amount of tangible asset is
30. Sir, if land is there in any example, in that case, the depreciation will be in negative.
Which one?
If there is land in any question, any example like that, there the depreciation will be negative, right? Because the prices it will not depreciate, right, for a land. It will be going up.
If it is not depreciating, then why are you depreciating? Why you charge depreciation?
So in
telling it is not depreciating. If it is not depreciating, there won't be any depreciation, that's all.
We don't need to put it any, the appreciation value also has not to be mentioned. No need of mentioning that.
If you consider appreciation value, then you are going conflict of the principle. Anybody can tell me why we should not consider the appreciation value? There is a principle. You remember? Concept and convention we studied, no?
Okay, where is anything which is right, yeah? Which is cannot be converted to cash, that we should not consider.
Yeah, but that, what is the principle for that? You are telling very normal answer. But what is the principle? Foresee the losses, but don't foresee the profit. See, when you will realize that, when you sell the land, if you realize the cash, definitely you are going to book that amount as profit. That time I cannot say. It is convention of prudence. Prudent convention. That means don't oversee the profit, but oversee the losses.
Yes.
Land is not having depreciation. Of course, I accept. Okay. That is by principle, not having depreciation. But market value of the land is not necessarily to be higher than the purchase price of your land. See, you are buying a land for 50 lakhs. Next month, you are going to sell it. You cannot claim that buyer, sir, I bought it for 50 lakhs, land will not have a depreciation, so you have to buy more than 50 lakhs. He will say, no, I don't want. The neighboring piece of land is available for 40 lakhs, so I will buy that land. That time, if you are in need of money, you are forced to sell it for less than 50 lakhs. That does not mean there is a depreciation. Market value is less. Land is not used and getting depreciated. That's a concept. If you use any other asset, any other type of asset except land, the automatically the value of the asset is coming down, reducing. The bike you are buying today for 1.5 lakhs, 1 month after you are going to sell, definitely they will say it's a second-hand bike, so I will buy only less than 20,000 or 30,000. So that case, depreciation. Market value and depreciation both are different concepts. But depreciation is enabling us to be close to the market value depending upon your book value. Okay, but does not mean that you have to always sell it for book value. Market value is more or less than the book value. Land value will not get depreciated, accepted by principle. Okay. Second point, it does not mean that the market value of the land of selling price should be always higher than the buying price of that same piece of land. That is different. And one more thing, come to accounting. Even though the land is really appreciated, even though the land is really appreciated, you will not get that appreciation in the books of account by considering minus depreciation. Okay? What is the actual meaning of minus depreciation? 1,80,000 is land value. 20,000 is the increase in the market value. So it becomes 2 lakhs. We will not do that. We will not do that. Okay? Right. So this 3,41,400 is the value of tangible asset of this company on this particular day. Okay. Then intangible asset. We have intangible asset. Goodwill is there. Goodwill. Intangible asset. Goodwill is there. So goodwill was 52,000, and there was a depreciation of 5,200. I mean amortization of 5,200. Write off was there now. So the net value is 46,800. That is being brought here. 46,800 intangible asset. Suppose if there is any patent, trademark, and all those things, find out the net value and then find out the total value, bring that total value here. Okay. Next, current, non-current investment. Look at the trial balance. Look at the trial balance. Okay. This is done, right? This is done. Look at the trial balance. Investments. Yeah, there was investment. Look at this. This investment. Investment is there. 2,50,000 rupees is an asset side. Investment. So write it in investment. 2,50,000. Investment. Then long-term loan given by our company to other company is nil. So I'm writing zero. Okay. Next, other non-current asset. Other non-current asset means any loss asset. Loss is there, that one. Or preliminary expense is there, that one will come under other non-current asset. Other non-current asset. In this case, preliminary expense. You remember, 60,000 was there in the trial balance. 15,000 rupees we have debited to P&L account. We have considered to P&L account of the current year. So remaining balance is 45,000 is shown as other non-current asset. It means why you have taken other non-current asset? You cannot take this and sell it. You cannot sell it out. Only namesake it is there. Instead of charging all the amount to current year income, we have charged a part of the expenditure to the current year income. Remaining, we keep it as just an asset. 45,000. So that 45 comes under other non-current asset. Next, current asset. Current investment. That means investment for 2 months, 3 months, 1 month. That is not there in the question. Next. Inventory. Inventory is there. You see? Inventory. Closing stock. Closing stock is there. I told you in the last class, you remember, adjustment item will be recorded in two places. Two places. So already we recorded closing stock in one place. Anybody remember? Where we recorded this closing stock?
P&L.
In P&L, to find out the change in inventory, we recorded. Okay. So now again, we are recording this. It's an asset for us. 80,000 rupees is a asset, inventory, 80,000 rupees. Closing stock, 80,000 rupees is inventory. And there is one more inventory, that is loose tools are there. So totally 1,18,000. Look at this trial balance. tools. Tool is an asset, current asset, inventory. Okay, tools. So 38,000 rupees put together is 1,18,000. Closing stock 80,000, and then tools 38,000. So 1,18,000. Next item in the asset side is trade receivables. What is trade receivable? Amount receivable from our debtors.
Goods.
So sundry debtors and bills receivable is the component of trade receivables. Look at this. Yeah, debtors are there. Debtors. Amount, this amount. 2,20,000 debtors. Debtor is always in debit side. Creditors will be in credit side. So this 2,20,000. Then this bills receivable, 61,000. So 61 plus 2,20,000 is equal to 2,81,000. 2,81,000. Okay. Next, cash and cash equivalents. Look at the trial balance. Cash, yeah, it is there. Cash and cash equivalent. 12,000 rupees. This 12,000. From there, it is taken and carried 12,000. Okay. Short term loans and advances given by our company to outsider. It is not there, so zero. Other current assets. Look at the trial balance. Any other current assets are there? Any other not taken? Goodwill already considered. No? Goodwill is considered for balance sheet. Okay, everything is taken from the trial balance. Look at this now. Everything is colored. Nothing is left out. So I am assuming that everything is taken. Now come to adjustment. All adjustments should be taking place in two places. I told you. This is already considered for profit and loss account as well as for the balance sheet. This also considered for profit and loss account. Okay. Depreciation also considered. Okay. Transfer to reserve is considered two times. You remember? One is in the appropriation account. Another one is in the surplus. Look at this. That 60 comes under here also one time. And one more time, it will be there in the appropriation. 60. Okay. That is why it is considered two times. Likewise, we have to check, cross check. Insurance prepaid, it's still uncolored. See, insurance prepaid is 1,500. It's considered in one place, that is in profit and loss account. Now it is an asset also. 1,500 rupees is an asset. That 1,500 comes under this category. 1,500. That is not number 11. Not number 11. 1,500. Any amount paid in advance to anybody is a other current asset. 1,500. It has come here. Now take the total of this. 3,41,400. 46,800. 2,50,000, 25,000, 1,18,000, 281, 12, plus 5,000, 1,500. Check the total. Anyone check the total and tell me? Are you checking?
Correct, sir. 10,95,700.
Correct, sir. 10,95,700.
So it should get tally. Okay. The balance sheet should get tally. This amount and this amount. Total of assets and total of liabilities should be equal. This is about financial statement or final account or the, what you can say, final account or financial statement or profit and loss account and balance sheet. That's all. Any doubt up to this? We have done journal, ledger, trial balance, and profit and loss account, balance sheet. We have done with the financial accounting. Any doubt?
Sir, one doubt. This other current assets we have taken insurance.
Insurance prepaid.
prepaid, how can prepaid insurance become asset?
What is prepaid insurance?
For the next year, we have paid in advance, but it is paid thing, no? The company has paid it.
Okay. So according to you, if anything is paid, that need to be
expense only. Yes.
Is it so?
I mean, okay.
No, I'm asking. So paid is expense. Anybody can reply to this girl?
Basically, it is prepaid expense.
That cannot be an expense.
Suppose it's paid for next year, so it should be accounted in the next year.
Okay, please go ahead. Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah.
Basically, this is the insurance. What is paid is for the next year, so it should be.
No, that's accepting. That is accepting very well. That's understood. Mm-hmm. But your question is, if something is paid, how can it be asset for me? Am I right, madam? That's a question, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So, if it's paid,
that should be an expense. Then why it's an asset?
Because we are yet to get the benefits out of it, sir. We are paying it. Paying for the insurance, but we are yet to gain the benefits out of it. Hence, we'll be considering it as an asset.
Okay. So, good question, actually. It's a good understanding. It's a basic understanding in accounting. Very beginning, we discussed this. Okay. Because we discussed that time only theory, so you might have not understood properly. Now, we are coming up with numbers, so you have a doubt. Look at this. I'll tell you. What is the difference between asset and the expense? That's a basic understanding. There are two types of expense. Two type of expenses. One is capital expenses. Another one is revenue expenditure. Don't confuse the words. Sir, we are telling revenue, then again you are telling it's an expenditure. How it is?
Additional expenditure
and capital expenditure. If you are buying a building, you are paying. Paying 10 lakh rupees to the promoter and you are buying a building. Madam, now what is this? Is it an asset or an expense to the company?
Building is asset, sir.
But you are paying, no?
Sir, insurance, no, sir. We cannot get it back.
According to you, I have to say paid, not even paying, not continuous tense. Paid, past. Pay 10 lakh rupees to the builder.
So we are having something in our hand.
What you are having, not in your hand, on the land, on the piece of land, you are having something that is called building. Similar to that, according to that explanation given by the other gentleman, you paid something to the insurance company and still you are having a paper in your hand. That paper gives an entitlement for you to claim any compensation from the insurance company if anything happens the next year. So still you are having something on your hand, a paper. What is the paper? The policy document you are having in your hand, which gives you the right to claim some compensation from the insurance company in the next year if any event happens in your business. It could be a life insurance or it could be a general insurance, whatever it be. Okay, that is why that part of unexpired insurance is an asset for the current year. Suppose you did not pay that insurance of the next year, your cash balance will be increased. Will you agree?
Yes.
If you did not pay that insurance premium of next year, in the current year itself, your current year bank balance or cash balance should be more than the balance what is there today with the tune of that much what you paid.
Correct.
So in that way, instead of it is there in your bank balance or in the cash balance, it is there in the hands of the insurance company, which you given for a contract to cover your business losses in the next year. That is why it is
asset. So anything which company will get a benefit from
is called asset. Anything which a company gets benefit in the future is called asset.
Okay, sir.
Goods account is asset account or goods account is asset or expense? Goods.
Goods is asset.
Asset. If you write purchase account?
Purchase account is expense.
Expense. Same logic.
Okay. Got
purchase
it.
Purchase account left out is closing stock. So closing stock is asset. Material consumed is expenses. You remember? Material consumed is expense. Total purchase you cannot consider as a total expense. Total purchase. Out of total purchase, how much goods you consumed, that is expense. Remaining amount of goods is asset. How you consider closing stock as asset? Same logic.
Sir, once we consume the goods and will manufacture something.
That becomes expense.
Okay.
Once you left out with still consumption, for the next year consumption, you are keeping it.
Okay.
What is my consumption year for selling? Next year sales, you are keeping it. Look at this. This closing stock is nothing but some left out amount from your purchase. This 80,000 is nothing but the balance of your purchase. Where is the purchase? Yeah. Out of 2,10,000 rupees of your total purchase, this 2,10,000 is the total expense towards purchase of goods. But out of this 2,10,000 rupees, still 80,000 goods are left with you for selling it in the next year. So this 80,000 is asset, 2,10,000 is total expense. So really amount spent on goods sold is only 1,30,000.
Got
it. If you consider 2,10,000, then you are treating this 80,000 also expense because it's going to give you the sales value the next year. That is why.
Okay.
So I told you, capital expenditure and revenue expenditure. Any expenditure which gives the benefit immediately and expire is called revenue expenditure.
Immediately. Okay.
Salary, rent, insurance premium, and everything. Capital expenditure means any expenditure which gives the benefit for longer period of time. Buying of land, buying of building, buying of motor car, buying of patent, buying of copyright, all these things.
Sir, why we call for the single thing? If it is a building, we call it as asset, we call it as capital expense, we call it as a tangible asset.
Wait. Building is coming to you only after that sale deed is done. It is coming to you. For you, it looks like one thing. But for accountant, for the practice, it is not just one thing. First, you will be paying money to the seller of the building. Money goes out. So I have to write something. If I write that as an expense, if I minus that from my income, then I will be landing up in a loss only. Current year, you are buying building worth rupees 10 lakh. So I have to tell the accountant, sir, it is not just building purchase of any expense, it's a capital expense. You should not treat it as expenditure to be minused from income. It should be an asset. Capital expenditure only is the base for your asset. Suppose a SOBA developer is buying land, that time it is not capital expenditure, it is a revenue expenditure. For them, land and building is the inventory. So buying of inventory is revenue expenditure.
Okay. So what I was thinking
cash goes to the buyer, seller of the land. You call it as capital expenditure. That capital expenditure results in creation of something. That something is called a building. That building becomes your fixed asset. Look at that. It is not just a fixed asset. Building is a fixed asset in one category. In other category, you are telling it is a tangible asset.
Yeah.
Building is tangible asset, fixed asset also. So you have to be categorizing that very carefully. All fixed asset need not to be a tangible asset. But all tangible assets are
capital.
Completed.
Capital expense.
I repeat it. I repeat it again. All tangible assets are fixed assets. But all fixed assets need not to be
tangible assets.
Okay, sir. I was just thinking.
One more point. Goodwill we talked about before. So goodwill cannot be purchased separately. I think you might have understood in that example I told you, A company
sir,
buys
goodwill
B company.
Only come when if a company buys another company.
Running business, yes. When the running business is purchased, goodwill comes into picture.
Yeah.
You cannot go to the company, you cannot go to anywhere market, sir, give me 1 lakh worth of goodwill, you can't buy it. So that is why I'm telling, goodwill is a part of running business. If you pay more than the worth what you buy, is called, the difference is called goodwill.
Sir, why good depreciation will happen for goodwill also? Maybe that the company which we bought may give us a profit. That's why goodwill depreciation is happening.
Then you are not understanding the concept of goodwill. No, when goodwill is arising, I just told you, know when goodwill is arising, you are paying more than
we are paying more.
We are paying more. So the payment of more amount is the last to the company. That is why it is stated as goodwill. That goodwill need to be written off. See, you paid excess money while buying a business. That excess money what you paid should be recovered from the profit of the new company coming to you, new company purchased by you. That is why every year from the profit of the new company, you are reducing this amount of goodwill.
Got it.
One fine morning, goodwill becomes zero. Thereafter, all the profit what you are getting is going to the owner.
Got it. Yeah.
So goodwill need to be written off. If you are not able to write off the goodwill, then the company what you purchased is not giving you any synergy, any kind of advantage.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, that's all little advanced. You will study in the fourth or fifth semester.
Okay.
Yeah, this is about financial statement. Any more doubt with regard to financial statement? Any commerce students, those who are there, please follow this format only. Those who studied commerce, those who studied balance sheet and all in the previous degree classes, you have to follow only this format, not the T format. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, how this question will be in the exam? Maybe we will have to create that final table. This table.
Which final table? Which table you have to create?
Yeah, this table we have to create by
this table and these all small.
Notes. Yes.
And questions will be this. This is the question.
So basically, we will be provided with the trial balance, right?
Yes, exactly.
From and the adjustment. The trial balance, we have to create the note and then we will be filling here.
Yes.
Got it.
This will be given to you. This is the question. Look at this. This is the question. Mm-hmm. Up to this is the question. Up to this is the question. Okay. Then you have to create this. Note number one should be given to the first note of the item which is there in the balance sheet. You might have noticed this is 12 I have given. How do I know it is 12? Because it's starting from one, no, it should start from one, but I have given 12. How do I know? I prepare all the note without number. Then I give the number according to the balance sheet order. Balance sheet first item should be note number one, like that. The last number of the balance sheet, note number, the next number of that should be the first number of profit and loss account. Suppose the balance sheet ends with number 10. Number 11 should be the note number of revenue from operation. Otherwise, do one thing. You know this format. You put note number for everything. Each and every row, you put one note number without confusion. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Not for this. The internal items. For this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, then 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. So normally 18 items are there. Put it 18, then 19 will be the first item of revenue from operation. 19. If any items are not there, you put 0. The note numbers are there, there won't be any note, you put 0. That's okay. No, sir, I don't want that. I will only number the items which are available. Number it accordingly. That's all. There is no hard and fast rule for that. Yeah. So this is about the financial statement. It is this. Any more doubt? in the next class. I think we can start in the next class the financial statement analysis. I request all of you to work out at least minimum three questions based on this model from the book given or the textbook what you buy or any other textbook, but in this format only you have to work out. Any doubt? Anything else regarding the beginning to now? If you ask, we can clarify. Others can also get an idea.
Any example for revenue expenses, sir?
A revenue expenses example. Anybody can tell me?
So one is salary paid.
The day-to-day expense is the meaning of revenue expenses. In a layman language, day-to-day expense is revenue expense. You tell me example now.
Electricity bill
maintenance.
Paid.
Sorry?
Electricity maintenance.
Yeah, electricity. But electricity maintenance also once in a month only, no?
Printing and stationery, sir.
But that is very well suiting under revenue expenditure. That is an example. Yes, you are right. But I'm asking very common expenditure.
Transportation.
Wages.
Ad hoc housekeeping, ad hoc cleaning, or something.
Which one?
Wages.
Wages, salary,
transportation.
Printing and stationery.
Telephone bill, coffee, tea, rent, puja expense, all these things.
That is also called operational expense in some terms, right?
Yes, operating expense.
Yeah.
Operating expense, not operational expense, operating expense. We call in accounting operating expense. Donation. Is it operating expense?
No,
it is not operating expense. Is it a revenue expenditure? No. What is the definition of revenue expenditure then? It should generate some revenue. I am spending something. Out of that, I should get some revenue. Purchase of goods is a revenue expenditure. How? I am buying goods, keeping in my company, putting a board outside, advertisement. Somebody is coming and taking that, buying that. I'm generating income out of that. So rent, for keeping that goods, I have to have a place. So I'm getting a place for rent. So rent paid is revenue expenditure. So revenue expenditure, operating expenses. Revenue expenses are purely accounting term. Operating expense is little bit of finance term. That means when you manage a company, suppose your company is having a profit. 2 crore is a profit in the current year. Everybody is telling a great company, it has earned 2 crore. But if you deeply look into the profit loss account of the company, it has got 1.5 crore as profit from the land which is sold by the company, which was purchased 10 years ago in Bangalore. So that 1.5 crore is not a operating income. It's not operating income. Otherwise, you take another example. There is a huge loss in the company. Huge loss. That means some accident happened. Some theft or fire happened. Because of that, there is a loss in the company. The loss due to fire is not a normal recurring loss, recurring expenses. It happens once in a while because of carelessness or some natural calamity or something like that. Okay. So those things are non-operating income and non-operating expenses. We'll discuss that in detail when we talk about the ratio analysis under the heading called operating ratio and operating profit ratio. The company should earn more money mainly from the core activity of the business. That's what I'm telling. The university should earn more money from the fees paid by the regular students like you. The university may also conduct some MDP or some FDP or some other development programs. From that also revenue comes to the university. We don't deny that is not a revenue, but that revenue may not be more than the normal revenue. That is why that is non-recurring. This is recurring. This is operational, operating. That is non-operating, or there is a very well designed auditorium is there in the university or in a company. The company is letting out that auditorium for some social cause or some kind of usage. Okay, that revenue, rent received from the auditorium, is not the operating income of a college or a company. There is another company, that company's main business is letting out the premises, letting out the premises. Okay, that company's income is mainly from letting out of properties. That is operating income. But for me, it is not operating income. But I will consider that income. Where I will write that income? Other income. You remember? In the profit and loss account, we have one concept now. Other income. I will write in this category, other income. If I have any income which are not of main business, I will write under other income. Yes, anything else?
Sir, can you please show the journals of the investment of capital, sir?
This
is regarding the second assignment which is uploaded in the LMS. That regarding that, sir, that when we are
in second assignment.
Yes, yes, sir.
Second assignment is about journal ledger trial balance, no?
Yes, yes, sir. That regarding the share capital, it's not clear for me, sir. So can you please help us to find out the ledger, how the effect of the ledger, that investment and issuing of the capital, equity capital and all.
The issue of capital journal entry, if you receive money in bank account debit, how much you are receiving, then two share capital.
That is the entrepreneur is investing that it will come as two share capital. When we collecting from the general public, how it would be?
You cannot collect money from general public. No, how can you collect money from general public? So far, they are general public. After you collect money from them, they become your
shareholders.
Shareholders. Okay.
Shareholder. The money given by the shareholder is called as? Money given by the shareholder is called as?
Share capital.
Madam, don't confuse. Promoter, founder, owner, all are same only. You only told us different name given for different time. This is also same logic. Promoter, founder, and then owner, shareholder. All are public only. These all people are public only, right?
No, if sir, somebody
from heaven, they are also public. Ambani is also public. Adani is also public. You are also public. I am also public. Everybody is public. If we give money to the company by getting a share from that company, entry is only in the company.
Okay.
Whoever it may be. Bank account debit to
share capital
account. Okay. If you give money and you take share in the company.
Okay.
The only entry. Who can, whoever it may be.
Okay.
So there is no difference between the promoter and the shareholder with respect to this money.
Okay.
But they are the one who is floating it, who is taking initiative.
Okay.
They are bringing the idea to us. We believe that idea and we give the money to them. They are also giving money to the company. Both the money is called as
okay. In that actually question is, sir, someone is saying, the question is in the assignment, someone is 25 lakh, it is investing, then further raising by issuing the equity share capital. So whether it will come as 50 lakh, like that is that's my doubt, sir, whether it will
be. You will minus 50% mark.
Okay.
You are getting the answer from me only now. So you have to give me 50% mark.
How no, I didn't understand.
Joke apart. Yeah, read it now. If you have a question with you.
Okay.
Readily available means just to take it and read it for the benefit of everybody and children.
Okay.
it is tricky also, sir.
Not tricky.
It's not tricky. Not these kind of sentences. No, that is why you are telling this tricky.
No. 10% debenture was also there. We are raising the money. We are investing. Wow.
Yeah. Read it. We'll clarify it now. We have some time. 2-3 minutes.
Yeah. Sir, that's what we have mentioned, sir. It's based on that assignment. It's not like you to take answer from you. It's not only to understand.
No, I just joking apart. Leave it.
Okay. So I was confused that if I am investing 25 lakh and again I am further raising.
No, madam, it's very clear. If you have assignment in your hand, just
to read it. No, sir. I was just working it out so that doubt.
Let me tell you, without taking that number, let me tell you.
Yes.
Suppose I am a promoter.
Okay.
Okay. I have 25 lakhs. The project, the total cost of the project, the total investment needed for the project, investment needed is 1 crore, assume. It is 1 crore.
Okay.
1 crore is needed. I, as a promoter, have an idea of this business. Okay. Hmm. As an idea, having an idea of this business, and I have money also 25 lakhs.
Okay. Yes.
Somebody was asking, after the break, I was reading a question.
Okay.
I want to collect money from the public. So 75 lakhs, I am short. Okay. So I want to collect. I'm approaching government. Government is telling me you can collect only 50 lakhs from the share capital. Okay.
Yes.
So
yes.
From the public, I'm taking 50 lakhs.
Yes, sir.
Still I need money. Still I need how much?
25 lakh.
Still I need?
25 lakh.
That time, I am just borrowing from the public. Borrowing from the public by issue of the debenture, 25 lakhs. So these two are share capital.
Yes.
This is borrowings.
Borrowings.
So this entry is for the first two.
Okay.
First two. And the second one, instead of this?
Debenture. 10% debenture.
How much ever the percentage I am offering to the public as interest. Okay, 10%.
Debentures.
Sure. Suppose you take only 20 lakhs from public. Somebody is working in a bank. You are arranging a bank loan. That time, bank account debit to?
Loan received.
Bank loan account. Whenever you receive money, cash account debit or bank account debit, for which you are receiving, from whom you are receiving, that decides the.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, we just went to the assignment which is mentioned in the LMS.
Yes.
But the timeline has come as a shocker, sir. It just shows that there's only one more week to do that.
One more week?
Yes, sir.
It is too much. No, we will reduce it. Maybe tomorrow, they have
to reduce it. Sir, not at all, sir.
Actually, yeah.
I'm not joking. I'll tell you one thing. See, it was uploaded. If you are still online, you can see the date of availability to the student, starting from which date. Is that it available for you?
Yes, sir. That is 13th of November. Yeah.
13th of November onwards, it was available.
True.
Okay. And the deadline is?
28th
December.
No, sir. It says
28th.
So almost 29 days given to you.
Sir, actually, we all were held up in the assignment one, sir, because it was a new thing for us. So that's the reason, sir. That is the reason we couldn't spend time on the assignment two part. So today is the first day we are looking at it. So
it was not the last day to submit your first assignment. No, sir. When was the first assignment submitted?
Last week, sir. Yeah, 10 days ago.
Maybe 13th.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
13th. From 13th, 30th, 29th. You have some 16 days, no?
True, sir, but right okay, after submission.
Me, I got your point. You tell me the last date of any assignment in the entire courses, last date.
13th, sir.
Which course? I don't want the course name, but at least you tell me the last, is the last date. Latest by this date, our all assignments are getting over. You tell me the date. Any idea?
So, sir, in few subjects, the second assignment has not started yet.
Okay.
They have not yet been posted. So.
But that cannot be taken as a...
No, sir. Some have started. I'll look into that.
See, it's very simple, gentlemen. You can spend some one day fully and you can finish it. Or daily, 1 hour or half an hour, you can spend, you can finish it.
Sir,
try it out up to 29. Okay, we'll see. Try it out. If not, we will extend by a week.
Sure.
Sir, is that mandatory?
Subject to the approval or subject to the deadline by the university. If university asks mark, I will stand by 29th. If university is having time to collect the mark from all of us, we will extend accordingly, a week maximum. That's okay?
That should do, sir. Extend.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, that's okay. That is fine. Anything else? That assignment is very, very simple. I have given for the sake of simplicity, because last time actually the assignment 1 and 2 put together is one assignment, and second assignment is real-time company analysis. That makes little more clarity on the company analysis, but this time I don't want to take much risk, because many people are finding lot of difficulty in analyzing the company's real-time. So I have not done it. But anyway, this is very, very easy. If you tell to anybody that it's an MBA assignment, they will laugh at me. But since considering all of our, limitations, we are not meeting each other and different background, the basic I have given you. But if you understand that, it's very easy for you to build up. Okay. So please, before the next class, I think next week we don't have the class, right? Next coming week.
No, sir.
We may not have a class. So after 15 days only, we are going to meet. Exactly. So by the time you have to submit the assignment, I'll change it. I'll change that date by giving a week extension, not extension, by week, a week more. Okay. Happy?
Very happy, sir. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Do the work. That's it.
Thanks a lot, okay, sir.
Sure. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Anything else? Any other point to discuss?
No, thank you, sir.
Sir, is
my
that
students are less in number. Actually, 22 were there in the beginning.
Sir, I have a question regarding the format we have been talking about. You mentioned that we need to follow the format that you have mentioned, but as I'm I have a commerce background, so I have been following the same format. So is there any other difference that you're talking about in
which
the format?
If you are following the same format, means you follow the same one. What's the problem?
Okay, cool. Thank you.
I'm not getting your point. You have been following this format only. What I have been discussing, the same one you have been following?
Yes, that's why, because I was confused, because you have been mentioning about the format all the time. So I was a bit confused that is there any other changes in the format?
Since 2013, the changes. Like
sorry? Yeah, so this is the same format that we have been, I have been working upon.
Madam, this is the, you should tell, this is the format you have been.
Yeah, I used to mention the same thing in the column, like JF number, then in the ledger balance, we used to mention the LF number, something, and there it was.
Don't confuse, madam. This is the beginning I was trying to explain to that girl about the ledger account.
Yeah,
ledger account, there is no change in the format. Journal entry, there is no change in format. I was talking about the format, means I am talking about the profit and loss account format. This okay. format. Have yeah, you worked on this format before?
Sure, that's the only thing that I was confused about. Thank you.
This is the part. See, actually, people will prepare in degree, your teacher might have prepared trading account like this. this, profit and loss account like this.
Yeah, because we used to prepare two side and one column. I mean, one sheet.
This might have been your format for your profit and loss account. Am I right?
Yeah, exactly.
So it should not be followed actually.
Okay.
What should you follow? You should follow this.
Okay. So no, I was actually confused that is there any changes in the general ledger and trial
balance? No. That you can never change. Okay.
Okay.
Who is the company's right to come and tell us not to follow that format? Nobody can tell. That is a basic one. Only thing is, this is the presentation. Journal, ledger, and trial balance is not an external document. That is only for the company. Okay, but this is an open document. Anybody can see this.
Yeah.
So while seeing this document, it should be uniform. So Government of India through Companies Act is coming out with this disclosure. Only you have disclosed this much.
Okay. Sure.
Thank you. Okay, if that is the case, we finished today. I thought of starting with the financial statement analysis. Actually, we are running short of time. 3 hours, we are late. One session, we have lost. I mean, we have used it for the same concept. By this time, we should have finished the financial statement analysis. If required, of course, we are meeting online only. No, one session we can take extra also. That's what normally happens for accounts class. We'll check with the office and we'll schedule it for that. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
And work out minimum 2 to 3 questions on profit and loss account and balance sheet.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir.
Thank you. If you have any doubt, you can just put a message. I'll reply to that. The last 15 days, the group is flooded with only book and its information. So please start with some discussion of any doubt or any concept in accounting. That's also helpful. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Chetan is there in this class or is from the B section?
Chetan.
Yes, sir.
You are there?
Yes, sir. I am not Chetan Kandale. He is in section A.
Okay. Thank you then. See you.
Thank you.